In the previous video, we adjusted our zombie's envelope weights and deform regions and painted a wrinkle map. In this video, we'll tune his jaw and eyelids and then use sculpting to apply some corrective touches. When the face rig was created, we made sure to place the jaw controls properly in the fitting stage so that our zombie's jaw would open and close correctly. Everything's working well with how the jaw moves, so let's go on to adjust the shape of the jaw area. On the Toon panel, click the Jaw tab to find all the tools you need for doing this. Let's start with the deflation tools. These basically control how sunken in the jaw and cheek areas look when the mouth is open. The deflation tools control the deform areas that are based on these jaw curves that we adjusted back in the fitting stage. So to start, the first thing you need to do is tune the deflation ease-in curve, which controls the overall deflation of the jaw. You can use this curve to cap the maximum amount of deflation that is used for the deflation upper jaw and deflation lower jaw tools. Setting a limit on the deflation is similar to setting limits on the deformation for the deform regions that we tuned in the previous video. First, increase the amount to an exaggerated value so that you can clearly see the deflation effect. Drag the last key to the left until the cheeks stop deflating. Our zombie hasn't eaten in a while, so his cheeks might need to be a bit more hollow-looking than for a typical character. You can also drag the key's handles to change how the deflation eases in and out of the cheek area. Now set the amount to a value that best represents the overall deflation you want. With these limits in place, let's tune the deflation upper jaw and lower jaw curves. We'll start with the upper jaw since its effect is usually more noticeable. The deflation range curve represents the jaw on the character's right side, chin, and left side. This curve may seem to be inversed, but its left and right sides are oriented according to the character's point of view, not yours. Increase these key's values to increase the sunken look just a little bit in the center of each cheek. You can drag the keys or choose key properties and enter a value. The values you change on this curve represent an offset from the deflation ease-in curve. You can do the same thing with the lower jaw's curve to deflate that area a bit. Now let's control the amount of fat under the jaw with the appropriately named fattening tool. As with the deflation tools, the fattening tool controls a deform area that is based on these jaw curves that we adjusted in the fitting stage. The inflate value increases the overall fat under the chin, which we may need to increase if our zombie goes on an eating spree. The keys in the curve represent the right, center, and left corners of the jaw. Again, the curve represents the character's point of view. This curve lets you control the amount and shape of fat distribution under the jawline. Our zombie is still a bit hungry, so we can keep the fat to a minimum here. Although we don't need to adjust it for our zombie, the sliding tools control how the skin slides over the face below the jaw area when the jaw opens. The sliding profile curve determines the shape and amount of sliding around the jaw, and the sliding ease-in curve determines the falloff of the sliding. When you raise the amount value, the skin becomes tighter so that there's less sliding when the jaw opens. Moving up the face, the eyelids are another area that you should check before you start animating. On the Tools tab, you can control how the eyelids behave with the options on the Tune Eyes panel. We'll start off by tuning the shape of the eyelids curves when they're in a closed position. As you can see, our zombie's eyelids don't quite close all the way. We'll fix that by adjusting each eyelid's edge deformation curve which defines the shape of the eyelid edge. We'll use the left upper eyelid as an example. The three keys on each curve correspond to the inside, center, and outside of the eyelid. So moving these keys around will affect the shape of the eyelid's edge. You can add keys on the curve to give better control over the shape of the edge, then adjust their key handles. When you're done with this eyelid, you can copy and paste its curve to the other upper eyelid. You can also do the same thing with the lower eyelids. Remember that we're tuning the eyelid edges to work for a basic closed eye pose. Some extreme expressions in this mocap sequence will make the lower eyelids move up too high, but that's okay since this isn't the final animation. In addition to the edge deformation curve, each eyelid has an edge map that controls the vertex distribution when the eyelid closes. If you have a high-res model, don't include vertices that are too high up on the eyelid, or else it will cause creases when they are pulled down as the eyelid closes. Our zombie is a low-res mesh, so we want to make sure that there are enough vertices used so that the texture doesn't stretch when the eyelid closes. We're going to lower the opacity and increase the softness of the brush because we need a more subtle effect when painting weights on this map. You can do the same thing for the other eyelids. Another thing to check for when the eyelids are closed is how the eyeball bulges under the eyelid. The bulge map allows the eyelids to deform according to the shape of the eyeball. With more realistic characters, you could add a corneal bulge to the eyeball geometry, which would be visible under the eyelid. Our zombie was modeled with smooth spheres for eyeballs because he doesn't need that kind of detail. Check that the bulge map is spread out evenly over the eyelid to cover the shape of the eyeball, which it generally does by default. We'll just remove a bit of weight at the top and edges of the map for this eyelid. You can do the same thing for the other eyelids. Now let's check how the eyelids respond to the movement of the eyeballs. Depending on where our zombie looks, you can see that his eyelids tend to stick to the eyeballs. That sticky factor is what you can tune with the eyelid sight direction tracking curves. When he looks down, the upper eyelids should stick and follow the eyeballs as they rotate downwards. And when he looks up, the lower eyelids should follow them as they rotate upwards. The eyelids are sticking pretty well for our zombie, but you could edit these curves as you did the others. A final way of tuning the face is by sculpting it with the sculpt tools. Sculpting is not something that you do when you first start tuning the face, but is more for doing minor corrective shaping, often in relation to the character's facial animation. Basically, if you can't quite achieve the desired results using all the tools and controls that we have covered so far in this series, the sculpt tools act as your last line of defense. We're going to sculpt the shape of the zombie's eyebrows to get a slightly more intense look when he has a frown expression. If you're using keyframes to create the facial animation, the first thing you do is pick a frame where the animation controls are in their neutral position or are zeroed out. Then move these controls to create the facial expression where you want the sculpting to be used. In our case, the mocap is driving the zombie's animation controls, so we just need to go to a frame that features the expression we want to use. Click the sculpt button that corresponds to the region of the face that is affected by the animation controls you moved. Each button refers to a different area that you can sculpt. Around the eyelids, the cheeks, the mouth, and the neck tendons. The skin button can be used for the parts of the face that are not covered by the other buttons. So for the eyebrows and forehead, we need to use the skin button. When you click a sculpt button, FaceRobot looks for any animation controls in that region that are not in their default position, and then generates a separate mesh for that region to use for sculpting. A number of animation controls were moved for this expression because of the mocap, so the sculpt mesh covers more than just the eyebrow area, but that's okay. You can use any of the standard Softimage modeling tools to sculpt this mesh as you would any other mesh. For example, you can use the Tweak Component tool, then activate the proportional mode to keep the geometry smooth as you sculpt. We'll move some edges, points, and polygons to create a deeper crease between the eyebrows than we could get with just a wrinkle map. And we'll make the eyebrows bulge out just a bit more. Because the sculpt mesh is separate from the head's mesh, nothing you do here affects the head until you click the Apply button. This bakes all your sculpt modifications into the FaceRobot head as a sculpt pose. If you're wondering where your sculpt pose went, you'll find it listed in the sculpt history. All sculpt poses that you apply to the head go there, except the ones for the mouth, which are listed at the bottom of the Tune Mouth panel. It's best to give each sculpt pose a descriptive name so that it's easier to identify later. If you want to check what the face looked like before the sculpting, just mute that sculpt pose. You can also select the points that are affected in that sculpt pose and do a bit of editing. And if you decide that you don't want to keep a sculpt pose, you can easily delete it. Now when these animation controls hit or get near to the position that you used when sculpting, you see that the sculpt pose kicks in. So now we've got our zombie all tuned up and ready for action. In the next video, we'll make him talk using the FaceRobot lip sync tools.